Echo and Harper Audio present Foreign Bodies, Pandemics, Vaccines, and the Health of Nations by Simon Schama. This is the author. On the 12th of February, 1950, Albert Einstein wrote to Rabbi Dr. Robert S. Marcus the following. A human being is part of the whole called by us universe, a part limited in time and space. He experiences himself, his thoughts and feelings, as something separated from the rest, a kind of optical delusion of his consciousness. The striving to free oneself from this delusion is the one issue of true religion. Not to nourish the delusion, but to try and overcome it is the way to reach the attainable measure of peace of mind. Prologue. In the end, all history is natural history. Old Pliny knew as much well before his last posting to the Bay of Naples beneath a volcano that would kill him. His nephew managed to compile 36 volumes of the natural history, as he called it, from his uncle's encyclopedic notes, and it was still not enough. But Pliny's data glut was more than sufficient to make the point that biology and ecology and the play between them are the ultimate shapers of human destiny. For the ancients, mischief for the gods notwithstanding, this was a truism. Aristotle, zoologist as well as philosopher, would not have disagreed. At this late point in the flash in the pan that is the paltry 10 millennia of human civilizations, we have returned to this chastening truth, that the matter filling million upon millions of pages of recorded history, wars and revolutions, the rise and fall of cities and empires, fevers of faith, the heaping up and the emptying out of wealth, has been circumscribed by what we have done to nature and what it has done to us. It would, of course, be absurd to discount the transformative power of human ingenuity. But the acme of its achievement, the natural sciences, as they have long been called, have revealed almost unimaginable powers of genetically amending the terms of human life, while at the same time making startlingly apparent the sobering limits of human agency. Bioecological imperatives, rather than the emperors of construction and destruction, are our true rulers. And science, rather than military hardware, is our best defense. Perhaps its chagrin at the realization that the best laid plans of mice and monsters are so many vanity projects compared to the entropy of the habitable planet or the eruption of pandemics that makes for reluctance to describe those existential crises in anything but the stale vocabulary of political and military history. Diseases are invaders. Measures to deal with them are plot. Bacteriologists and epidemiologists, an alien elite, the microbe and the scientist in cahoots against homespun wisdom. The health of the world contracts into the health of nations, even when the latter cannot be sustained without ensuring the former. Much madness has arisen from this ongoing drama of false consciousness, and many of the perils arising from its obstinate perpetuation. What follows are scenes from this late period episode of the human comedy, and like much comedy, they could not be more serious. Chapter 1. Et in Suburbia Ego. Giovanni Boccaccio to Cameron. First day. Thus it came about that oxen, asses, sheep, goats, pigs, chickens, and even dogs, for all their fidelity to man, were driven away and allowed to roam freely through the fields where the crops lay abandoned, and had not even been reaped, let alone gathered in. And after a whole day's feasting, many of these animals, as though possessing the power of reason, would return, glutted, in the evening to their own quarters, without any shepherd to guide them. In March 2021, the 13th month of the COVID confinement, the peepers, in their vast multitudes, sang out again. Down in the swampy wetlands below our house in the Hudson Valley, millions of Pseudacris crucifer, cross-bearing false locusts, but actually minute frogs, puffed up their air sacs and warbled for a mate. At spring for you, the peepers are so tiny, an inch or so long, you'll never see one, no matter how carefully you creep up on them. They're blown-out songbags are nearly as big as the rest of them. It's all they are, innocently inflated peeps of expectation. They're not alone. In recent years, the soprano peepers have been accompanied by a bass rhythm section. Wood frogs, Lithobates sylvaticus, a tattoo of deep quacking, punctuated by raspy burps. They and the peepers survived bitter winters by means of antifreeze cryoprotectants stored within their bodies. When ice crystals begin to form on their skins, their livers flood the bloodstream with glucose, sending vital organs like the heart, its beating paused, into a dormant but protected state. 70% of the frog's body water can then freeze without compromising the organs that will magically reawaken in the spring. To help matters, wood frogs can recycle urea through their urine. So if you were to come across a wood frog in deep winter or expose a tiny peeper beneath the leaf litter, their sparkling jelly rigidity would lead you to assume they were dead. A twist from your fingers could snap a leg, so don't do that. For as the Hudson Valley light goes pearly in the afternoon stretch out, the superficial body ice of the frogs melts away, and along with that decrystallizing resurrection, wild singing begins. At first, a mere tea time tuning up by scattered vocalists, but by sunset, building into a massive chorus, an entire Albert Hall full of peepers. There is always mating business to be getting on with and only a month or so to get it done. Quick, quack, peep! The teeming amphibians ecstatically multiplied, even as much of humanity sank into another engulfing wave of infection. It's a commonplace, but no less true for being so, that the empty desolation of cities, the grim, still silence of lockdown streets and squares, was offset by the irrepressible burgeoning of nature. We saw it, the budding and blossoming, the buzzing and butterfly fluttering on our walks in parks and on heaths in our gardens and on windowsills. The cheek of nature, impervious to our fearful distress, flaunting the sociability of its flocks, gaggles, and mysteriously choreographed starling murmurations, the avian corps de ballet. For a while, back then, the grounding of jets and the stilling of traffic scoured away the rusty scrim of pollution from the skies. Avians replaced aviation. Ruby-throated hummingbirds were seen in unprecedented numbers around Kennedy Airport, their tiny wings beating 50 times a second, more miraculously engineered than anything attached to aircraft. Children in vast conurbations, Beijing, Mumbai, São Paulo, Los Angeles, few of whom had ever seen a truly blue sky, now crane their necks to a clarified space hitherto glimpsed only in storybooks and video cartoons. At night, with ambient light dimmed and road traffic muted, stars glinted, needle sharp. The Milky Way sloshed across our field of vision. While we hunkered and cowered and ordered home delivery, flora rioted, fauna trespassed, parliaments of legislators were reduced to socially distanced barking from the hollow shell of their chambers, while parliaments of birds flocked and chattered. We tweeted with our fingers, they tweeted with their lungs. Those with the sweetest song showed off, none more liquidly around here in the Hudson Valley than the Carolina wren nesting under our barbecue. The more we retreated into digitally numbed companionship, the more brazenly the company of animals advanced towards us. Coyotes raved in the midnight backyard. A weedy ditch by the road became the habitat of a family of water voles, pups slickly backflipping at each end of the conduit. One early summer morning, I chased a chipmunk around the house before dislodging the speedy trespasser from behind the television. Reckless possums crossed the roads at night, though their habit of playing dead before the odd oncoming car was often a prelude to being actually dead. Morning roadkill was evidence of nocturnal roamings and ramblings by hitherto seldom seen critters. On the path leading to a local art centre, weasels and milk snakes lay side by side, cartoonishly flattened, as if mutually KO'd in a small hour's brawl. At the entrance to our local woodland trail, a sign advised walkers not to make nice with the black bears. Everything, except us, seemed to be emboldened. Reporting on record fox sightings in her North London neighbourhood, a friend chuckled, "It's laughing at us, nature is." So it was, the low chuckle of gallows humour. But the joke's on us. Things are amiss. Species are out of place, or incautiously testing human presumptions about where their place actually lies and what its boundaries might be. Lockdowns or not, migrants, two-legged and four, are on the move to wherever subsistence beckons. The domain of the wild now includes urban gardens, parks, and alleyways. Even before the pandemic shut the doors on residents, wild boar from the woody slopes of Mount Carmel were seen on the streets of Haifa. But since the pandemic, the pigs, off the menu for both Muslims and Jews, and thus unconcerned by hunting predators, have been regularly grazing central reservations, trotting over road crossings with the paws to drop dung, and waking sleepers with their snotty snuffling as they tear and munch on weedy backyards. Regular fights with pet dogs often end with Lulu the Pomeranian or Yossi the Labradoodle the worse for wear. For once, a Haifa schoolboy's claim that a pig had eaten his homework, along with his sweatshirt and a final slice of pizza margarita, turned out to be true. In North Wales, mountain goats from the Great Orme, munching potted petunias off Llandudno windowsills, supplied much-needed online entertainment. But the crashing of barriers between wild and domestic spaces has an ominous side. Displacement is a symptom of ecosystems under stress. The capybara, roaming through the upscale gardens of houses in Nor Delta on the outskirts of Buenos Aires, would not be there had not the suburb been built by draining extensive areas of the Luján River Delta, robbing the three-foot-long rodents of their natural habitat. The relentless growth of Mumbai, a million new residents a year, has pushed its eastern and western suburbs into areas normally reserved for leopards. Specifically, the 100 square kilometres of the Sanjay Gandhi Sanctuary. Deprived of prey, the big cats have strayed beyond the preserve. At least 50 of them have taken up residence within the city, sustaining themselves from the enormous population of feral dogs, occasionally sampling an amuse-bouche of a Dachshund or a Siamese cat. When a small herd of elephants broke out of their reserve in southwest China in April 2020 and were video-tracked lumbering through a car dealership and scouting kitchens by probing through open windows with their trunks, they became an online sensation, described by one transfixed fan as magical. But this was not circus time. It was a symptom of something gone awry. The causes and consequences of this ecological disruption are complicated. On the one hand, it's not good for the leopards to become Mumbai street creatures. On the other, they are doing the bloated metropolis a favour by culling the feral dog packs, which often include rabid animals. But then again, there would not be so many of those wild dogs were it not for the introduction a decade ago of diclofenac, an anti-inflammatory drug commonly used for livestock in the 1990s, which ended up driving the third player in this urban drama, white-rumped vultures, to near extinction as a result of scavenging drugged cattle. A South Asian vulture population of 40 million in the 1980s now numbers around 19,000 40 years later. This is more than a catastrophic species loss, bad enough though that is. The dramatic depletion of vultures has unpicked the ecological threads that have tied human and animal culture together in India for centuries. The reverent freedom given to sacred cows by Hinduism so that they might wander the streets until their bodies...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.